own food.
Chase, Damien speaking. Once again, thank you very much for your patience. We are still waiting for the train on platform 2 to push forward. For those guests, our dining room is unfortunately located on the other side of the platform, so once the train on platform 2 pushes forward, it'll attach us here on platform 3, and then we'll be able to commence dinner. Because of this, dinner will be delayed half an hour, so for those people with a 6 o'clock dinner, it'll be put back to 6.30. 6.30 will be 7 o'clock. Unfortunately, I haven't been able to see everyone. There are some 100 guests, so if I haven't had a chance to see you, there are all spots are still available with time, so there is no need to panic. So if you make your way down to the Outback Explorer Lounge, see myself, I can get yourself a drink, and we can certainly allocate you a time for tonight. But there is no need to panic. We still have all times available for this evening. Once we do have an update of when we are moving forward, the trade manager will go through more proceedings. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, this is your lounge host, Damien, speaking. I've just been informed that Wayne and Richard, the Matilda Cafe, will be open this evening for dinner from 6 p.m. right through to 8 p.m. The train on platform 2 should be departing very shortly, and it'll make its way forward, and then it'll attach us here on platform 3, and we shall commence our journey. Just repeating that the Matilda Cafe will be open from 6 p.m. this morning through to 8 p.m. So if you go down and see Wayne and Richard, and they'll certainly be able to look after you. Thank you.
Oh, we are.
We're moving.
Oh, hey.
Oh, wow. Somebody's pushing.
Oh. We're moving. My goodness. Oh, reckon here we come.
Was it Zierha aus welcher?
Well, wir haben, ich bin aufgewachsen in Büren, bei Nienburg in Niedersachsen. Nienburg. Also, das ist nicht weit von Bremen. Mhm. And dann ist meine Eltern sind nach Gelsenkirchen gezogen.
Oh Gott, das ist ja bei uns.
Ja, yeah, mein Vater hat gearbeitet in der Kohlmine. In einer Kohlmine?
Ja. Yeah.
Für 5 Jahre und dann sind wir hierher
gekommen.
Ja.
Meine Eltern sind genau umgekehrt. Mein Vater hat zweite Heimat in Schleswig-Holstein gehabt.
Oh, ja.
An der Ostsee, Palen am Klumpen hieß das, aber es ist ein ganz kleines Dorf.
Ja.
Ich weiß nicht, Neustadt heißt es. Oder heißt es auch Nienburg? Ich weiß nicht, Nienburg. Neustadt ist das, ne? So, und dann, aber Nienburg kommt noch auch aus irgendeinem. Und meine Mutter hatte zweite Heimat.
Attention all staff, attention all staff. It is time to kindly ask you to please man the doors. Once we have come to a complete stop, I will make an announcement. You'll be able to open them. This goes for the guests as well. If you could just please just remain seated until we do a final stop with shunting, and I will make an announcement. It'll be free to stretch your legs. Thank you. Thank you.
Not very exciting.
No.
I have definitely. I've been here about four or five.
Peterborough. Obviously that's a pre-recorded announcement and unfortunately we can't do time travel 2 hours quicker, so we still are due into Adelaide Parklands Terminal around just after 5 o'clock this afternoon. So we'll be stopping very shortly in Peterborough. As I said, we are picking up a guest here. Once we have picked up our guest, so we will continue our journey south through to Adelaide. Thank you.
Thank you.
We should go to the Grand Central Station, which is the old station in the middle of the city, in the center of the city, because it's old station like Grand Central in New York with the big clock.
The one in Sydney? Everything.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not a bad station.
They put this long distance train outside of Adelaide, outside the center.
And get your stuff, and we'll be gone. She will come.
The old jail on the other side, the little old jail, the original.
No, it works, yeah. I don't know. Let
us know if you ever find out.
Yeah. And now today in the German news, they say now the governor of Berlin, he has to quit now.
Yes.
But after 5 years, you know. Oh, there's one I know. She was on the game last week.
Okay.
Yeah. They've got to be back. Not last week. Where did you know them?
Us out with our single curve, and this makes up the straight portion of the track, which is two-thirds of the 676-kilometre track across the Nullarbor Plain. Now, the Nullarbor Plain is the largest single piece of limestone in the world, honeycombed with caves, rock holes and blowholes. It does not readily support vegetation, however, you'll see lots of salt bush and sometimes everlasting daisies after a good spring rain. The Nullarbor is reported to be 20 to 25 million years old and covers some 250,000 square kilometres. Now that area is greater than the size of Victoria, twice the size of England and four times the size of Belgium. The soil is made up mainly of seashells left behind by the huge sea which once covered the desert millions of years ago. As you will be able to see very shortly, it's a truly remarkable landscape. So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Nullarbor Plain and also travelling on the longest straight stretch of rail in the world. Contemporary music, sounds from the bush, and short stories from noted experts the regions the Inner Pacific travels through. Now, guests wishing to listen to Radio Inner Pacific, it's just a matter of adjusting the volume dials in your cabins, but you will need to switch your touchpads to Channel 5, ladies and gentlemen. Looking out the window, a lot of guests ask about the red flower that you see from time to time after a good spring rain. Now, that flower was called a ruby dock, or also wild hop. Now, the story behind the flower is that it runs alongside the railway track, and this area all the way to Perth Plus runs also on our GAN. Now, this is evident. It's supposed to be native to the Middle East when the Camelias came over, and they used to put that ruby dock or wild hop in their saddles, just to make their saddles softer. Also, the camels used to feed off and they used to make a tea out of it. Now, all those years of trekking across here, they've dropped seeds, and you'll see the ruby dock. So that's where it's come from. It's native to the Middle East, Syria and Afghanistan, around those areas. And you'll only find it running alongside the rail track. And so ruby dock or wild hop. Thank you.
No, there's something coming up.
Controversial area known as Maralinga. This area is where the British tested nuclear bombs in the 1950s. The area has been treated with the waste being removed and buried in holding areas. The name Maralinga roughly translates to the Aboriginal meaning of place of thunder, but the name was bestowed by Europeans and not Aboriginals. Ladies and gentlemen, we've picked up a little bit of extra time. We're only 60 minutes away from arriving into the outback at town of Cook, where I mentioned earlier. We'll be able to jump off the train, stretch your legs and have a wander around. Cook is located on the Transcontinental Rail Line, 2,829 kilometres from Sydney and 1,521 kilometres from Perth. Despite its isolation, until 1998, Cook had a two-storey school, a swimming pool, a hospital where the Royal Flying Doctor Service aircraft could taxi from the dirt strip runway to the front door. The hospital also doubled as the Cook weather station. And there was even a nine-hole golf course at Cook. The main source of water for Cook was bore water, which was pumped up from 90 metres below the surface and treated by reverse osmosis before use. Water is now carted to Cook by rail from Port Augusta, and it's roughly the same cost per litre as fuel. In 1982, some railway volunteers from Port Augusta and Kalgoorlie, they met at Cook for a weekend and planted 600 young trees. They called their project the Greening of Cook. They hoped to create an oasis in the outback, but the Nullarbor defeated them and only some of the trees still remain. Cook is now a refuelling station, has almost closed down as a town, with only four residents remaining. The residents get their weekly supplies from the Indian Pacific, and there is also a rest house. This is where our train drivers will finish their shift. Although almost deserted, the town remains full of character, as you'll see when you have a wander around. So approximately 60 minutes away from Cork, ladies and gentlemen. 30 minutes after our arrival. Now, all guests will be assisted from the left-hand side of the train, and for your own safety, police remain on the left side of the track and do not for any reason step onto or try to cross the rail line as freight trains pass without warning. Now, also take care stepping off the train as there is no platform at Cook. Steps will be positioned for you to step down to the ground, and if you require assistance, please don't hesitate notifying a train crew staff member. The water will be turned off at our stay in Cook, so please refrain from using toilets on board. Now, for your own safety, the administrators of Cook would like us to stress that no trespassing is allowed into any abandoned buildings, and this is including the school residential properties. Some of these buildings are now condemned and are all unsafe to enter. This is a legal matter and may be enforced to protect the general public. Now, there is no public address system at Cook, so listen out for the one long blast of the Cook fire siren, and that'll be your call to reboard the train. I will blow the siren approximately 30 minutes after our arrival. Thank you.
Dann würde ich mich nicht verstanden.
that's really good. Synopsis of
much as 6 hours away from the hospital. That's like a fine doctor. be with leak-proof in Australian situations. The only time people are normally seriously bitten by snakes is snake bites them on bare skin. So we've got hands and feet usually, and that's because someone's been incautious about where the boy unlocking it with they put their hands or their bare feet. So if it's just walking around at night with bare feet, without a light to guide you, it's not a very sensible thing if you're in a bushy place, because a lot of our snakes, especially in hot weather, come out at night. So don't do things like that. Don't put your hands under or around things unless you have a kick first. So under normal circumstances, you do have to get lucky if you're bitten. And if you are bitten, chances are you're never too far away from health in Australia, that the outcome is going to be quite good. In the arid desert regions, how good are reptiles at survival? What are their survival techniques? As you're looking out these windows, you're seeing an awful lot of what looks like unproductive and barren landscape. But from a reptilian point of view, it's a landscape that's full of possibilities. Lizards and snakes have a number of attributes that just set them up nicely to be successful in desert environments. Possibly the most important one of these is that the food they use for energy production, reproduction, and growth. Now, that doesn't sound anything very radical, but us mammals use about 90% of what we eat just to run our bodies, just to have our high body temperature and high energy available whenever we want it. Reptiles, by contrast, are animals you can describe quite accurately as solar power. They power up using environmental heat when they need to be active, and when they rest, they simply power down, so they're able to eat out there, fight against that, and try and burn up lots of calories and stay warm. And so that means that a given area of landscape can support many more reptiles than it can things like mammals or birds that run this high energy sort of economy. And in arid zones, reptiles often have an advantage over these potential competing animals simply because although deserts don't produce much, they produce enough for a lizard or a snake, but that's not enough for something like a gecko or a bandicoot. So in desert environments, mammals and birds often fluctuate greatly in numbers. When deserts are good, they're often very good places. And so for a time, going is very good. There's water available temporarily. Mammals and birds often build up in large numbers, but then when things dry out, they have to disperse, or sometimes they die out locally, and then reorganize again, and it becomes a bird time again. Reptiles, like snakes, tend to be there at about the same rate all year round. In been a drought year, snakes still doing what they normally do, and nothing much has changed. What's happened in the Australian situation is that we have been a very successful place that we have lived, so a number of lizards, the whole of Australia, a number of lizard species was living in places described as arid, semi-arid, something up between 400 and 500 species. And in any given area, you may have as many as 60 species. So, it looks very quiet out there. It's actually not just very good.
So, Mark, in a place where children seem to be scared, what do snakes live on?
Okay, sure. Snakes and lizards are the basic predators. They're usually in the middle of the food chain, so they can eat smaller things than them, and for the most part, they then have their own enemies that use them as food. Lizards, by and large, are insectivores, invertebrates, and many of them are not specialised, they'll eat ones that hang around, like bus eaters, relatively toxic, aren't they? Snakes eat a variety of foods elsewhere in the world, but as it happens, the cobra family is made of humanoid snakes. Lapids are all vertebrate eaters, so they all eat backbones and smaller species into lizards. Large species, once they've been upsized, will eat mammals and birds. So the snakes are sort of carnivores, and the other larger life around them, and the lizards are the smaller life. There's some specialization goes on as well. So aspects of the Australian desert which promote that. So one is that grass-eating termites are a real feature of the Australian desert. Another group that, for whatever historical accidental reasons, have been relies on the ants to provide the food supply in an organised way, since the ants only eat ants when they're in a column of ants moving along, beside a row of ants turning back to the forwards and pick them up and eventually fills up the stomach. And if you get them ants running around all sorts of chaotic directions, they're usually going to be picking up the food. So the ants organisation sort of acts against it when the horny devils are around. Protein, lots of chemicals to digest, and because reptiles don't care too much about protein, it's very little bit of a difference in a long way. So they can use these sort of very poor quality foodstuffs to thrive. Which lizards are we more likely to notice? Which are more on display? Both of them are small and keep out of sight, but Australia does have some, by world standards, relatively large, in some cases by world standards, very large lizards. And so some of those can be noticeable even to the most casual tourists if they're going through the areas where they live. Australia has a large diversity of animals that we call goannas in Australia, up in overseas where the same families occur, called the bottom of the lizards, which is the same smack of it. But goannas are the world's largest lizards. Nearby in Indonesia is the world's largest Komodo dragon, and it's a member of the same group. So we have relatives of Komodo dragons that are acting almost sort of like small carnivores would act in other parts of the world. So things like, we don't have things like small foxes and, you know, ferrets and stoats and measles and things like that. What we have are these predatory lizards, which are out eating things like rabbits and small mammals and birds and things like that. So they're quite predatory, quite active, aggressive and very successful carnivores. Very fast moving animals. So one can often sort of see them best actually if you're in a car. They're these long, slim shapes, their heads up looking at you as you're driving up them. And they get used to cars, and often allow a car to drive relatively close to them. So the moment that you get out of the car, you'll be recognised normally as something very unreliable and unstable and run. And there's no point in trying to chase after them. So you can get a closer shot because they'll have all the advantages and they can run in a cluttered environment a lot faster than a human being can. And they usually don't have to run very far before they find a rabbit. Their own burrow that they've done, which is a shelter that's quite a other lizards that you might see, especially right across the whole Nullarbor train line route actually, animals whose names vary depending on what state you're in. And so the large, slow-moving, armour-plated lizard that in Perth they would call the bobtail, in South Australia they call the sleepy lizard, in Victoria they call the stumpy-tail lizard, and in New South Wales they call the shingleback. About the same animal, a big, slow-moving lizard that's, to some extent, doing in Australia what a tortoise would do in another part of the world. So, if we talk about these lizards, there's shinglebacks, just to call them something for the time being. They belong to a group called the blue tongue lizards, which are also an Australian group, very large members of the major lizard family that we have, which are called the skinks. Skinks are...
Ladies and gentlemen, we're only a few minutes away from the Western Australia and South Australia border, approximately 4 kilometres. Thank you.
Get your camera ready. Get your camera ready.
Yeah, yeah.
Predatory lifestyle, not much that can't run away from a shingle bat. And so they become mostly herbivorous. They can run past little daisies and pig face and other sort of blossoms and sort of succulent leaves that flower briefly in desert areas and have a large body size so they can sort of digest the meat. That's not really the end of the
Super.
Exist out in the open in these rather bare habitats.
You heard?
No,
you missed it,
yeah.
Let's try to do it once, because to actually break through those heavy body scales...
There wasn't nothing on this side.
There was something.
Was there?
Yeah.
Well, I might have videoed it then.
On both sides, but it was just very small.
Yeah, you think that fireworks and stuff go off, didn't you?
So one occasionally finds...
mentioned earlier, the red one is a ruby dock, or also known as wild hop. The purple flower is Salvation Jane, or another name, Patterson's Curse. The white flower, the drivers tell me, is wild onion weed, and sometimes you see the yellow one as well. That's mustard turnip.
In the 1950s and 60s in Western Australia, this finding enough food brought the eagle into disgrace, to the point where it was considered a pest. Farmers believed that the eagle was responsible for taking young lambs in decent enough quantities to threaten the sheep industry. Continued complaints prompted the setting up of an extensive field research program by the government to separate fact from fiction in the case of the accused eagle.
We saw the only one of the two inhabitants.
Probably.
Well, yes and no. Years of exacting investigation at the nesting sites uncovered bones and fur balls that show that the eagle ate a wide variety of food, from rabbits and reptiles to smaller birds. And yes, the occasional lamb. It all depended on the Nullarbor's climate. Had there been good rains or not, and what sort of food was on offer? In the case of the lambs, post-mortem tests showed that the lambs taken by eagles were either already dead or were mismothered and sickly with no milk in their stomachs. In the case of rabbits, in a good year on the Nullarbor, there are enough rabbits to feed every eagle in Australia. It was common, the researchers tell us, to find a nest with a couple of healthy eagle chicks sitting within a circle of a dozen or more dead rabbits, draped around the edge of the nest, waiting to be eaten.
And were taken to Perth in Sydney by taxi, and that's where my dad got a job as a journalist. Previously, he was working in journalism, a company officer, a camp policeman, and of course, I was 16 at the time, my father was 14, so with him it was not difficult. They put him straight at high school, and they were not quite sure what to do. So I can't remember why I didn't want to go back to school, but so they finally worked out something that I could go as an assistant nurse in Auburn, in the little Auburn hospital, which is in the middle of the mountains. So I remember this amazing journey I've ever experienced, to go on this bus from Bathurst.
Main Street of Kalgoorlie.
Good morning once again, ladies and gentlemen. Very shortly we'll be arriving into East Perth Rail Terminal. I do ask all guests to remain seated and wait for the announcement that it's safe for you to disembark, and when you do, watch your step as there is a gap between the platform and the train. Train crew, can we please make our way back to our carriages for our arrival? Thank you.